Hello friends, this is a bonus video that goes along with the You Can Be Well class, and I hope that many, if not all of you, have been able to attend either in person or online the three class series on You Can Be Well. And in that class, we went over the five paradigm shifts that I say transform your thinking and set your feet firmly on the road to wellness. In our last class, class three, we talked about the three pathways to wellness. What's coming at you, what's going into you, and what's coming out of you. And at the end of the class, we had some questions, and because it was a really full class, we didn't get to everything. And when I left that night, I came home, and as my mind kind of always does, I think through what we talked about and things that really stood out to me, things that I could have gone into better detail on. And I really wanted, there were a couple of things that really stood out to me, like, oh, I wish we had a little bit more time to go into that. I think that really would have helped people. So this video is designed, and there'll be a few more, to get a little bit deeper into some of those questions that were asked. So one of the questions, and it came in a couple different ways from a couple different people, was what specifically should I do? What do I eat? They're getting the concept, those of you that are watching, getting this concept that we're talking about of using different types of diets, of adjusting our macronutrients, our protein, our carbs, and our fat to get different results in our life. When we're in a losing phase where we're going to raise our healthy fats and lower our carbohydrate, keeping our protein pretty moderate so that we can begin to drive our car down the weight loss path. Or if you don't have weight to lose, drive yourself down the anti-inflammation path if you're doing some healing diets to cleanse your body or to drive inflammation out and bring healing to your cells, we're gonna move that car in the direction of perfection. But then we wanna take a pause because our bodies are designed to sustain us long-term. That's how God made us. So if we're losing weight or detoxing or whatever that, even in an anti-inflammatory diet, if you're really making a lot of changes at a significant speed, which if you're doing some of these things in a healthy way will often happen, your vehicle gets going, and picks up speed down this hill. And there's a mechanism in our design that says, hey, something's really changed. We need to stop all this until we figure out what's going on. Are we okay? Are we in some sort of danger? All these questions inside our body come up, and our body is designed to keep us alive. So we can, this is my proposal, stop that moving vehicle every 10 pounds or every landmark in whatever it is you're going about. If you're looking for a symptom to resolve, when you see a change in that significantly enough that you can stop, herein lies a difficulty. A lot of people want specifics. How long do I stay in keto if I'm losing weight? How long do I stay on my anti-inflammatory diet? It's really hard to put a number to it because every single one of us is so uniquely different. Our goals are different. Our body's response to what we're doing is different. And the little tweaks we're gonna need to make all along the way are different. So as much as I would love to be able to say to you, plug these numbers into a formula, do this for this many days, do this, I can't do that for you. But what I can do for you is to say, listen to your body, be wise, don't be afraid of failure. Okay, because failure, what we label as failure, is what we learn not to do. When something doesn't work, you learn what not to do. And sometimes that's even more important than knowing what to do. You can scratch things off the list and say, that didn't work. Here's my suggestion for really figuring out the details of your plan as you go. Get a health journal. Date it, write in it every day if you can. If not every day, really regularly. Notes about how you feel, what your symptoms are, what your goals are, if your goals have changed, if you've seen resolution in certain symptoms, if you've seen certain symptoms get worse, what are you eating? What supplements are you taking? What does your exercise look like? What have you learned? And really take notes. We think we're gonna remember this stuff, but a lot of times, especially the more time passes, we forget what worked and what didn't work, and we end up going around and around the same circle too many times. By keeping a journal, you can get to know your body. And here's a really cool thing that I've seen happen in my life and in the lives of people that I've helped, and I know will happen for you, is you begin to become friends again with your body. When we're in a disease state, whether it's overweight or a diabetic situation or any other kind of dis-ease, our body is functioning outside of the ease that it was created to function in, we lose that friendship with our body and we almost become enemies. Like, I'm gonna make my body do this. Then my body says, I'm gonna protect you from yourself because you're harming yourself. And we have this adversarial relationship. Well, as we begin to heal and learn and take notes and be willing to explore and become a student of our bodies, we develop this friendship again with our bodies, a trust and a communication that we can now begin to listen to the signals of our body, because our body isn't so much having to protect us from our own self-damaging practices and habits and toxins that we're taking in. Our body begins to communicate back healthy messages. In order for this to happen, a lot of healing has to happen. And that takes time. It didn't take us overnight to get to whatever state we're in now that we're wanting to fix and improve. So we need to give ourselves adequate time to heal. I'm not saying necessarily that it's going to take as long to get well as it did to get sick, because who really knows when that path started? You may have started to make little things, and actually many of us are born with toxins in our body from our mothers and from the lifestyle that we're around. So we kind of come preloaded with some difficulties to overcome. But as we begin to progress either in the direction of perfection or to continue along the direction of disease, that timetable of when symptoms actually begin showing is really different in different people. Again, can't give a specific timeline based on our genetics, which is really only a small portion, and our environment and our choices. So it's a big picture that we're beginning to gather all the pieces of the puzzle to, lay them out on the table, work with them, and develop this picture, putting it together piece by piece of what true wellness looks like for each one of us, spirit, soul, and body. So there's a key to remember that you, me, we were designed to be a living spirit, the very spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, Holy Spirit, dwelling within us. That is the power that brings our soul, which is our mind, our will, and our emotions to life within this physical body that we all have. Don't you want to be a living soul, a vibrant, healthy, thriving, living soul inside of a body? We all have the body we have. Can't trade it in. Unfortunately, we're not like a vehicle that we can go to the dealership and trade it in on a new one. But here's a cool thing. Our Heavenly Father has designed our bodies to renew. At a cellular level, our cells reach maturity, die off. I love this word, so I have to say it. Apoptosis. Isn't that a great word for cells dying? I just picture them popping, which is probably where the word came from. They burst and die and new cells are regenerated. We want that process to happen. We don't want these old cells living on. This creates further disease state in our body. Many things stop apoptosis in our body and we don't have this healthy turnaround of living cells. But when we begin to do the things in life that are healthy for us, eat well, drink well, minimize the toxins that are coming at us and getting into us, and then measuring what's coming out of us, looking at how we're feeling, maybe working alongside a nutritionist who can help you in that regard, or someone who can run some lab tests for you and actually see what minerals, what toxins might be coming out of you literally in your urine or your feces or even your hair for a mineral test, and begin to make those healthy changes. So as much as I would like to give you guys those specific times, measurements, all of that, we have to become students of our body. And what I can give you is this idea of a health journal. You can begin to become that student, make notes, and learn from it. That doesn't mean that there's not some really great, great specific guidelines. And I'm going to end this video with what I hope is a quick little view of what I do. And again, because I can't say, okay, everyone should do this, I'm just going to tell you what I do in a typical day. And then you can look at it, do your own research with your body, online, listening to people like me, and put together a plan and follow it. So again, coming from a spirit, soul, and body place, I'm going to start in the morning because that's how we look at days, even though biblically days start in the evening. We'll come back around to the evening. But I try when I first wake up in the morning to focus my heart and my mind on my Creator, my Abba Father. And I try to have the first thought and the first words out of my mouth while I'm still laying in bed be, "Good morning, Abba." And I try to tune into what He's saying. It's really crazy, but when we first wake up, isn't it amazing how our mind can already jump to the things of the day that we have to do or the worries in life? So I try to be really purposeful about that and tune into my Heavenly Father first thing in the morning before I even get up. Then for me, when I do get up after I go to the bathroom, I weigh myself every morning. Someone did ask the question, how often should you weigh? If you don't have some unhealthy relationships with food and weight, like an eating, what the world will call an eating disorder, or I call an unhealthy relationship with food, to where a weight on a scale could throw you off, if you're at a pretty objective place, I do recommend weighing yourself every day. Not on a digital scale, though, because those numbers can play with our mind. I like a, I guess you would call it an analog scale with a little needle that shows a range, because in our thrive zone that we're aiming towards, we live in that range. I just remembered, I'm telling you what I do, so get back on track. All right, I weigh myself every morning. It's a good clue for me as I wake up in the morning to see where I'm at in my thrive zone. Am I right in the middle? Am I ebbing a little high or a little bit on the low side? And then it helps me to kind of put in perspective what I did the day before. Next, I'll go out to the kitchen and I always start with a big glass of water. Oftentimes I'll mix my vitamin C powder into my water. I'll put in a full gram usually, or close to it. And I often will mix in my green drink too, which is just a barley drink. I get that through my dad actually, but there's a lot of companies I've taken it through. And I mix that all up and I have about 16 ounces of that. Sometimes I'll just have water in the morning or water with vitamin C, but for me, that's really how I start the day. I do love coffee, but I have learned that too much caffeine rattles my cage. So I've come up with my own special coffee. I do make organic coffee. I usually buy whole beans organic. I grind them myself as fresh as can be, and we use fresh water. But I only put a little bit of coffee in the cup. I boil some water. The rest is water. And then I love, love, love coconut milk. I often make my own. If I don't, I buy a brand that has only two ingredients in it, coconut and water. It comes in a carton and not in a can. It's really hard to find coconut milk in a can that doesn't have additives, some sort of guar gum or even citric acid. So I have found a brand that's in a carton that is just coconut and water. Otherwise, you can make it. That's another video. So that's my morning drink. But I usually try to wait at least 30 minutes from having my water and green drink before I have my coffee and then sip on that. Those of you that know me, who have heard me talk before, have heard me say, I don't eat until I've gone to the bathroom. Number two, pooped. That's because I don't want to put more food in my body until I have gotten rid of everything that my body has detoxed and gotten ready to be evacuated this morning. So I wait. And because I do intermittent fasting to where I'm at least not eating for a 12-hour window while I'm asleep between dinner the night before and breakfast, and often up to 18 hours, I usually am not hungry. And that coffee gives me just enough with the coconut milk in it to feel satisfied and warm and full. I'll also continue to drink water in the morning. A rule of thumb for me is for every cup of my coffee that I have, I drink a cup of water. So if I'm gonna go for a refill on my coffee, I'll drink at least 8 ounces of water first and then refill my coffee. For me, I usually find I'm hungry about 10 a.m. And breakfast for me looks something like a fried egg over easy. I get farm fresh eggs that are organic free-range chickens from free-range chickens that roam around, not fed, commercial, chemically laden diet. And I will often saute some spinach or vegetables from the night before and have that with my eggs. And I almost always have kimchi, some sort of fermented vegetables, which I make myself. Or you can buy in the store if you can find wild fermented kimchi. It's very easy to do, another video and we'll teach you, or you can look it up. That's where I learned how to do it. Look it up on YouTube, how to ferment your own kimchi sauerkraut. No vinegar. I have that with every meal because it boosts my probiotics. Also, sometime before breakfast, I do take a thyroid support because of all the years that I ate grains, not knowing how sensitive I was to them, created an autoimmune condition within me that damaged my thyroid. So I do take a natural thyroid support that I get from Dr. Jocker's. I can put a link below this video. There's plenty of other places you can get it from, but that's a good one I found. I take that and usually a B vitamin complex before breakfast. Make sure your B vitamins are methylated. They should say like methylcobalamin in the ingredients. Some people can't methylate very well and you won't be able to absorb your B vitamins. So you wanna have them in this methylated form. That's just a little side note. And for breakfast, again, so then probably around 10, I have that breakfast. And honestly, sometimes I'll make a flaxseed, what I call a flaxseed pancake or flatbread. I learned that from the Wheat Belly cookbook. And it's simple. And I'll have that. It has no flour in it. It's just flaxseed, an egg, and some oil, a little bit of baking powder to make it rise. and put my egg and spinach on that or leftover vegetables and kimchi. I am honestly not hungry all day long. And I work pretty hard. Sometimes I'm at home working from the computer and doing things around the house, but I work training horses. So I'm outside and I'm very active and I drink water all day long. So what I do, I have a 1/2 gallon glass jug. I actually went and bought some apple cider in a glass jug because it was a perfect size and dumped it out, cleaned it really well, and that's what I use. In my water, I put vitamin C, again, at least 1 gram for the whole day in there in the powder. I add some stevia right now, and I also put in a pinch of boron, which is a mineral, and I get it. This sounds crazy, but you can look it up. It's very reliable science behind this. I use borax. I don't know if you've ever seen the box of 20 mule borax. It's not a soap, even though it's sold in the laundry detergent. It's simply a salt. It's boron. And a pinch of that has, I won't go into it. You can look it up. There's a lot of different health benefits, but you just don't want more than like a pinch in your water, something you can squeeze up. And that's what I do. I put that in my water. I will be switching to, instead of using the stevia, a prebiotic that I get from Just Thrive. But right now I just started their probiotic and I'm on it for 2 weeks before we start adding the prebiotic, which is already sweetened with stevia, into our water. So in a few days, I'll switch over to that. So again, I don't really eat all day long. I just drink water. Sometimes I'll have some almonds with me just in case I feel hungrier, or an apple and cheese stick or something like that. But really, I just don't get that hungry. Movement. Somewhere during the day, I move. Because I'm a horse trainer, I'm outside, I'm walking up and down the hills and riding horses, I get a lot of movement. If I'm home, I try to do some sort of exercise. And I've had some knee issues because of a horse accident I was in. So even walking recently has been very hard on my knees. One of my very favorite forms of exercise is Pilates. I love mat Pilates. And it's something easy to do at home. It strengthens you, tones you, stretches you out all at the same time, and it really develops a strong core. So I try to do that, and often I'll put on a video, either a health and nutrition video, a Bible video, something that I want to learn about. Oh, that reminds me, I left out a really, really, really important part of my day. When I first get up and I've tuned into the Holy Spirit, I come out and have my glass of water, the next thing I do is hit my knees. And I share this with you. I actually thought about not sharing it with you because there's something about what the scriptures call our secret place. But then I realized David in his Psalms talked about his secret place. He said, 3 times a day, I come before you and I fall on my face. So I want to share too. To me, literally bending my knees, getting on my knees in prayer before the Lord, even though before I've even gotten out of bed, I tune my heart into him. There's something to me about that physical act of bending my knees and bowing down before him to pray. And just sometimes I just sit quietly with him, or I'll pray the Lord's Prayer. But that's an exercise for me that I just don't let go of. And I do that before bed too. It reminds me to have a repentant, humble, submissive heart, and to recognize that while I've been asleep, my Heavenly Father has not slumbered or slept. He's been watching over me, and I can't wait for him to fill me in on everything that's gone on in the day. And then I spend the next pretty good chunk of time in his word and in prayer. And one of the secrets his Holy Spirit has revealed to me is what I call the secret of the empty page. Oftentimes, maybe we have a prayer journal and we come to our quiet time to pray and bring all these things up before the Lord, to bring from what's on our page to him. But I try to sit at least for a little bit of time with an empty page and ask him to speak to me, and realize that one of the greatest aspects of prayer is that I'm hearing from him rather than telling him everything that's going on. He knows what's going on with me. Although it's a good exercise for me to voice my needs to my Heavenly Father, an even greater exercise is to be still, know that he is my Abba Father who loves me, and to wait on him and listen and let him speak. I then spend a really good amount of time. I get up early and in his word. His word is life to me, and I love studying, and that's where I try to start, especially because I study a lot of other things with horses and nutrition. I want to make sure that my mind is first tuned into the truth of the word. Okay, so jump forward. So all day, I've moved during the day. I really haven't eaten. I've had a really nice breakfast, usually around 10. Haven't eaten. By the time I get home in the afternoon, which is somewhat early, I'm usually home by 4, I am getting pretty hungry, and we usually eat a pretty early dinner. And for us, dinner looks something like some sort of clean meat, like a sirloin or a ribeye or salmon or chicken. And always at least a couple vegetables. So it might be steamed broccoli and a salad. And my salads are full of all kinds of stuff. I'll put a few walnuts on there, sunflower seeds, avocado, beets, which I make myself, and that can be another video. I love, love, loved beets, and they're really healthy for you. And I'll put those all on my salad with olive oil and vinegar, so we at least have those two vegetables. And then sometimes, depending on where we are at in our thrive zone, we will have a starchy vegetable like sweet potato or red potatoes, mashed red potatoes or something like that, squash of some kind. Recently we've been eating a lot of mashed cauliflower, which is wonderful and totally fits into the ketogenic diet if you're in the losing phase or in the anti-inflammatory phase. So we'll have dinner. And I do have my thyroid support usually when I get home from work before dinner. That's for me. And whatever supplements that I'm currently taking, we take a really great spore-based probiotic with dinner. I don't drink with my meals, but been drinking that healthy water all day long. We usually eat dinner by 5, and sometimes it's a little bit later, give or take, but that has proved to be a really good time for us, and it gives our bodies time to digest before bed. And after dinner, I try not to snack too much, but if I'm living in my thrive zone where I'm not trying to lose weight, there's room for a little bit of snacks, and my intermittent fasting window is closer to 12 to 14 hours. If I've had some days where maybe I've eaten a little bit outside or a little bit more or haven't gotten activity and I'm towards the upper end of my thrive zone, then I'll be real purposeful at night to just drink tea and not to snack or to have anything after dinner. And then in the evenings, again, is a time of refreshing. Epsom salt baths for me are wonderful because of my joints and my work with my body. I'm also really trying to connect with my husband at that time because we've both been gone for the day. We connect over dinner. When we had our children living at home, dinner was always a family time. We sat around the table and touched base. And so important that we connect with one another. And that was something that we've been purposeful about. In the evenings, because sometimes I take alpha lipoic acid or some other supplements that are detoxing for different organs of my body. If I do that, even with just taking the probiotic in the beginning, before bed, I'll drink some activated charcoal mixed in water. What that does is bind to any toxins that my body is going to release because our bodies tend to detoxify at night. I've heard different time ranges, but seems like from what I've heard from about 11 p.m. till like 4 in the morning. Some people say it doesn't start till more like 3 or 4 in the morning and goes till maybe 11 a.m. But somewhere in that range is when our body is doing the most detoxification. So I make sure that I've taken all my supplements and anything away, an hour away from my charcoal, because charcoal is going to absorb whatever is in your gut at the time. So we don't want to absorb these minerals and vitamins that we've taken. So I take that charcoal before bed and I go to bed. And I've really hydrated, and I use castor oil on my lips and on, under my eyes. And sometimes I'll sleep with an eye mask on, and you can put castor oil on your eyelashes and eyebrows. And that actually is very healing and can darken and lengthen your eyebrows and eyelashes, ladies, a cool little tip. And I do sleep with that mask a lot of times, and that just blocks out all the sun or all the light that might be coming from around the moon at that time at night or whatever. And it just makes it really dark. I also really tried to stay away from screens, TV screens, phone screens for at least an hour or 2 hours before bed, because it really does mess with our circadian rhythms. Or at least on your phone, if you're on your phone, you can change the setting so that you don't have the blue light. It can be more in the red light zone and the warmer tones, I guess it is, and that helps. So I think I've pretty much covered an average day for myself. The only day I don't do that is on the Sabbath. The Sabbath for us is Friday night through Saturday night, and I don't weigh, I don't really think, I just I tend to follow the same pattern because it's so close to the same, and we spend more time in prayer and worship, my husband and I together, and fellowshipping with other believers, and it's just a time for our bodies to rest. So I just let the Holy Spirit lead that day. If I take my vitamins, if I drink my water and coffee the same way, or when I eat and don't eat, I just let the Holy Spirit lead. And I really try to release all that in the soul realm, mind, will, and emotions. And I just rest in every way possible. I hope that was helpful to you, to have a little sneak peek or an insider view into what a day in the life of Stacy looks like. It changes sometimes too, because seasonally things change. Sometimes we're more hungry than others. Sometimes we're traveling. So, but that's what a typical day looks like for me when I'm home and doing my routine. So, I love you all. There will be more videos to come, some answering some more of the questions that were in class three. But this is twofold, the health journal of how to really measure and say, what specifically do I do? And then a little bit of a picture of saying, what do I do personally? Have a super awesome day, and I'll see you again soon.